morning's Holy Eucharist, Rite 2, contained in our service leaflet and in the Book of Common Prayer. Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Bless the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the lessons.
Reading from the book of Exodus. In the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages, as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. The people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" The people thirsted there for water, and the people complained against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone." The Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people, and take some of the elders of Israel with you, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and go. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock of Horeb. Strike the rock, and water will come out of it, so that the people may drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm number 95, please read responsibly by half verse. Come, let us sing to the Lord.
Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving.
And raise his loud shout to him with songs.
For the Lord is a great God.
And a great King of all hosts.
In his hand are the caverns of the earth.
And the heights of the hills are his also.
The sea is his, for he made it.
And his hands have molded the dry land.
Come, let us bow down and bend the knee.
And kneel before the Lord our Maker.
For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand.
Lord, that today you would hearken to his voice.
Harden not your hearts as your forebears did in the wilderness.
And there are none, and on the day of the Master, will they take me.
They put me to the test.
Though they have seen my works.
40 years long I detested that generation and said,
"This people are wayward in their hearts, they do not know my ways."
So I swore in my wrath,
"They shall not enter into my rest."
The reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us. Because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us. Much more surely then, now that we have been justified by his blood, will we be saved through him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more surely, having been reconciled, will we be saved by his life. But more than that, we even boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, to whom we now have now received reconciliation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to John. Jesus came to a Samaritan city called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired out by his journey, was sitting by the well. It was about noon. A Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone to the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria? Jews do not share things in common with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. The woman said to him, sir, you have no bucket and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us the well and with his sons and flocks drank from it? Jesus said to her, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life. The woman said to him, sir, give me this water so that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water. Jesus said to her, go, call your husband and come back. The woman answered him, I have no husband. Jesus said to her, you are right in saying I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true, the woman said to him. Sir, I see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you say that the place where people must worship is in Jerusalem. Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. The woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will proclaim all things to us. Jesus said to her, I am he, the one who is speaking to you. Just then his disciples came, they were astonished that he was speaking with a woman. But no one said, what do you want? Or why are you speaking with her? Then the woman left her water jar and went back to the city. She said to the people, come and see a man who told me everything I have ever done. He cannot be the Messiah, can he? They left the city and were on their way to him. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, Rabbi, eat something. But he said to them, I have food to eat that you do not know about. So the disciples said to one another, surely no one has brought him something to eat. Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to complete his work. Do you not say 4 months more than comes the harvest? But I tell you, look around you and see how the fields are ripe for harvesting. The reaper is already receiving wages and gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor. Many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I have ever done. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. And many no longer believed because of what, and then more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, it is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world, the gospel of the book.
Thanks be to God.
Words in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank Deacon Susan for that wonderful reading of a very lengthy gospel, and thank y'all for listening.
a lot going on here. It's quite a story. And the last Sunday we had Jesus with Nicodemus, kind of pushing that out to the Sanhedrin, Leah of the Jews, and the good news is coming into that part of the world. And today we have Jesus pushing those boundaries once again. The disciples were aghast that he's talking with this Samaritan woman, and at the end of the day, bringing the good news and the gospel into Samaria, where she ends up being a missionary. But let's back up and take a little bit of a time with the context of this. It is important for us to appreciate how scandalous it was for Jesus to be talking to this woman and to be talking with her. She is a Samaritan, and she's there by herself at noon. It's hot. Jesus has plopped himself down by the well. He was ready for a drink. And he said, "Would you bring me something to drink?" Why is she there at noon? By herself. There's other women in the village. Why do we think she was there at noon? When do the other women come? When would you come to a well if it's hot and dry outside? When would you come? Early, first light. And guess what they would do, as we're led to believe? The women would come to the well to draw the water, and while they're there, what else would they do? And talk. All the news that's fit to be news. It's sort of like going to the vegetables and fruits at Publix. You know, kind of just walk around there. You're going to hear lots of stuff going on. It's where news would be moved about in the community. But she wasn't there because she was not welcome. She had been ostracized. She was deemed to be not fit. She was not clean. She was not welcome. So she had been moved outside of that community. She was alone. And the women who were going there were drawing water from a well. Now, most of us don't get our water out of a well like with a bucket. We generally have a tap. And hopefully if the plumbing's working, it's going to come out and be okay. That's how we get our water. But for most of the world, even today, getting water to well is a pretty common thing. In fact, there's incredible missionary efforts that are going on as we speak, drilling water wells, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, drilling water wells for villages so they have access to clean water. Wonderful, incredible ministry there. But the closest some of us have ever gotten to wells were windmill wells. When I was little in Texas, it was during a drought. Things were hot and dry. All the little creeks had gone away, and where there had been water, there was no water. So if we're visiting my uncle, who had a little ranch outside of Austin, he'd walk from the house with him and go up toward where the cattle were, where the barns were, maybe about a mile or so up there. And it was hot, and it was dry, and it was dusty. And why we were going that time of day, I don't know. But the good news is, at the top of the hill there was a windmill, one of those wonderful Chicago-made aeromotor windmills. And it would be whirling, and it would be pumping, and there would be water in the trough for the cattle. And there on the windmill was an assortment of had been crafted tin cups, and they hung there on that windmill. And you had a little side space where you could pump it, hand pump it, and get water to come up from that well that you could get to with a tin cup. Well, on a hot, dry day, that water in that tin cup tasted like it had been in an ice bath. I mean, it was so delicious. And, you know, I always go back to that memory and trying to understand how precious it was for Jesus to be there, hot and dry and thirsty, and wanting that drink of water, wanting to drink from that well. But what we're talking about here is not so much worrying about the heat and the dryness and getting that drink of water, but it's the water from the life that Jesus talks. I am, I am. Jesus is bringing to this woman living water, and this is what she is given. But what we need to capture here is the story of who this woman is, and look at our own story. Because what happened is that Jesus sat down at the well to listen to this woman. John already knew her story, but he listened. He listened. Do we listen when we sit at the well? When we sit and talk? Are we listening? He did not judge. He did not say, He did not judge. Nor did he permit the disciples to be in the judging business. Instead, what Jesus did was accept this woman for who she was, where she had been, her pain, her story, and he embraced her. He loved her and gave her the gift of the living water to be with Jesus. Jesus said, the Savior, Messiah, what do we hear? In the midst of all those words, Jesus said, I am. And the woman heard that. And she took that good news and went into her village and said, I've been with the one who is the Messiah, who is the Savior. She became a missionary. So for us, Jesus accepts us for who we are, where we are, and where we've been. I look at that as an opportunity, particularly during this Lenten season, to look at things that I've done. And there's some good things. God bless you. I've done some good things. But there are some things I've done that were wrong. There's some things I've done or not done that would be considered selfish. There's some things that I've done or not done that would be considered dangerous. And all the rest of them would fall in the category of just plain stupid. No other cap, that's all you can say about it. And the beauty of that is that God comes to us in Jesus at the well. We sit there and we are accepted for who we are and where we are. And we look for a amendment of life, the gift and grace of the Holy Spirit to guide us to be like Jesus and to bring the good news to others. But I would say also that this is an incredibly wonderful opportunity for each one of you to embrace that and to wonder, who can I sit next to and listen to them? Not in judgment, but to learn to know them better, and to love them, and invite them to come and to worship God, to get to know Jesus a little better, to get to be part of a community that is drinking the living water. Amen.
Amen.
Now let's affirm our faith at the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God,
the Father of the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things are made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Continue with the prayers of the people. Loving God, we are the people of your pasture and the sheep of your hand.
Hear our prayers as we call upon you. For you're a great God. You're great above all gods. Let us come before God's presence with thanksgiving, raise a loud shout in psalms.
Gracious One, your church has been justified by faith, and we have peace with you through Jesus Christ. Nourish us with the water of eternal life and feed us with the bread of Christ, that the church's food may be to do the will of God and to complete Christ's work. Let us come before God's presence with thanksgiving.
And raise a loud shout in psalms.
Eternal One, give to our leaders the wisdom of Moses, and let everyone who holds authority in the world grow in faith, that they may use their power to speak hope to the outcast and marginal, and to bring drink to all who thirst. Let us come before God's presence with thanksgiving. God of peace and compassion, let your spirit and truth go forth into the world to uphold and protect vulnerable women, the poor, and those who live in places of strife and conflict. Let us come before God's presence with thanksgiving. Nurturing One, let your harvest of righteousness abound in our community, that we may be a spring of water gushing to eternal life, bringing comfort, hospitality, and relief to all who are near us. Let us come before God's presence with thanksgiving.
Praise God, shout psalms.
Healing God, guide all who suffer through the wilderness of their pain. May their suffering produce endurance, and endurance produce character, and character produce hope that does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. We pray especially for Margaret, the family of Doug Stone, Tanya, Judy, Elaine and Buster Slay, the family of Jack David Brumfeld, Lil, Carol, Susan, Betty, Kairos outside of Northwest Florida and South Alabama, Liz, Rich, Brian, Bob, Ella, John, Rosellen, David, Rhea and Larry, Kim and Robbie, Joyce and Bob, Dan, Leslie, Kathy and Tony, Father D, and all those in need of prayer during this pandemic. Are there others? We also pray for those on our long-term prayer list, Denson, Cynthia, Stephen, Judd, Margaret, John, Donna, Kristen, Chuck, Martha, Adrian, Warden Gladys, Will, Kermit, Ivan, Dean, Ryder, Donald, Janet, Jean, Tom, Jean, Vicky, Pat, Russell, Doug, Myra, and Francis. We pray for all first responders and all in the armed forces and for their families. Joe, Tim, Christopher, Lewis, Patrick, Brandon, Ashlyn, Sarah Grace, Bernie, John, Cody, Hunter, Joey, Austin, Julian, Eric, Zane, and all in harm's way. Are there others? In the diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for our fellow parish of St. Michael's in Ozark, Alabama, and for the commission on Crucio and those attending Crucio out of Camp Beckwith today. We pray that you weave our diocesan capital campaign into your kingdom and consecrate to your glory that which is given. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Church of South India. Come, let us sing to the Holy One. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation, offering grateful thanksgivings, especially for the birthdays of Jim and Mary. While we were sinners, Christ died for us, reconciling all humanity to God. Give your water of eternal life to all who have died. Let us come before God's presence with thanksgiving.
And raise a loud shout of psalms.
Guide your church to draw comfort from the deep wells of your refreshing presence, O God, that we may share in Christ's work of reconciliation. Give unto others the living water of your Spirit, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. You and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, in glory everlasting.
Amen.
Now let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
us, merciful God.
We confess to you as sin against you, in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us. That we may abide in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
May Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Now may the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Christ, peace be with
you. God's peace.
That was an awesome sermon. I don't know why you appointed me the whole time, but.
Peace. Grace and peace to y'all on this, the Lord's Day, and so glad that you got your clock set right. Please be seated. Deacon Susan has some announcements to kind of lock together here.
Yes, I want to thank you all for coming, and thank you again, Father Johnny. Wednesday, we have our healing and Eucharist at 10 o'clock in the morning, and then in the evening at 6 o'clock, we have our soup and salad, and we have entertainment. And instead of just Don, we're going to have Hammers and Harmony again. The group that played the first time is going to come back and play for everyone again. They had a good time, as we did also. And of course, we've got great soups and salads. And would love for all of you to come back again. And anyone who missed it.
And potluck.
Potluck today, yes. Potluck today after the service.
Let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself as an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
hearts. Let's give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who was tempted in every way as we are, yet did not sin. By his grace, we are able to overcome every evil and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, who have ever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy.
Subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive. Christ is risen.
Christ
will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son. The holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. At the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Now that the Savior Christ has called us, we are bold to say, "Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power and glory, forever and ever.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Christ died for you. You know, even your heart's life fit. Thanksgiving.
Serve you.
Almighty Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among us this day and forever.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.